Good morning to all of you. Let us continue with the problems. Previous class we have solved some numericals taken from the VTU old question papers. Probably this is the last problem we are taking on heat exchangers. After this we will start with the heat transfer with the phase change, that is the boiling and condensation. Let me read this problem. A refrigerator is designed to cool 250 kg per hour of hot fluid of specific heat, 3350 joules per kg degree Celsius at 120 degree Celsius using parallel flow arrangement. 1000 kg per hour of cooling water is available for cooling purposes at a temperature of 10 degree Celsius. If the overall heat transfer coefficient is 1160 watt per meter square degree Celsius and the surface area of the heat exchanger is 0.25 meter square, calculate the outlet temperatures of the cooled liquid and water and also calculate the effectiveness of the heat exchanger. This problem has taken from VTU old question paper July 2019. Let me read the problem once again. A refrigerator is designed to cool 250 kg per hour of hot fluid of specific heat, 3350 joules per kg degree Celsius at 120 degree Celsius using parallel flow arrangement. 1000 kg per hour of cooling water is available for cooling purposes at a temperature of 10 degree Celsius. If the overall heat transfer coefficient is 1160 watt per meter square degree Celsius and the surface area of the heat exchanger is 0.25 meter square, calculate the outlet temperatures of the cooled liquid and water and also calculate the effectiveness of the heat exchanger. Now, first of all, let us calculate the heat capacity rate of the hot and cold fluids as we did in the previous problems. Similar way, in the previous problems, what we did, CH, capital CH is equal to MHCPH, that is the mass flow rate into specific heat, that is the heat capacity rate of the hot fluid. It is 250 kg per hour converted to kg per second divided by 3600 into its specific heat 3350, which is upon calculation 232.64. watt per Kelvin, and heat capacity rate of the cold fluid. Similarly, as we did for the hot fluid, it is CC equal to MC into CPC. MC, it is 1000 kg per hour converted to kg per second into 4186, that is a CP of a cold water fluid. That is the water usually in the problem he has given here. 1162.77. Among these two heat capacity rates, hot fluid is having minimum heat capacity rate, so hence it is C minimum, and cold fluid is having maximum heat capacity rate, hence it is C max. Using these two, let us calculate the heat capacity ratio, capital C, which is equal to C minimum by C max, which is equal to 232.64 divided by 1162.77, which we have calculated, which is appears upon calculation, it is 0.2. Now let us calculate the number of transfer units is equal to, that is given by NTU, that is equal to overall heat transfer coefficient into surface area divided by C minimum. Overall heat transfer coefficient is given 1160 watt per meter square degree Celsius into surface area is 0.25 meter square and C minimum it is 232.64. So effectiveness value NTU is 1.246. We know the effectiveness expression for parallel flow heat exchanger is given by this expression. It is denoted by the symbol epsilon 1 minus exponential into bracket minus NTU into bracket 1 plus C bracket or double bracket here over divided by 1 plus C. This equation is also we have developed in the derived in the previous class or developed we can say, and it is available in your heat and mass transfer data handbook and any of the heat transfer textbook, so you can use that one. Upon substituting all the values NTU and C value, it is 1 minus exponential into bracket minus 1.246 into bracket 1 plus 0.2 divided by 1 plus 0.2, that is a C value is heat capacity ratio is 0.2. So upon calculation, it is effectiveness is 0.646, that is 64%, and it is multiplied by 100, the effectiveness value is around 64.6%. The effectiveness expression. Effectiveness expression, the epsilon is equal to given by considering the heat given up by the hot fluid. It is CH into THI minus TH0 divided by C minimum into THI minus TCI. TCI. So upon substituting all the values, So effectiveness value you have calculated. So this using the equation what we have developed or derived, or you can also directly take it from the heat and mass transfer data handbook. And it is also possible to evaluate this effectiveness value from the graphs. We have taken also some of the examples how to evaluate the value of effectiveness directly from the graph. But only thing is graphical solution leads to some error. It is better go with the equation. But even there is a error with 5% error, it is manageable. 0.646 is equal to 120 minus TH0 divided by 120 minus 10. So this in this case CH equal to C minimum, so hence they are eliminated. Upon calculation, exit temperature of the cooled liquid, that is cooled liquid TH0, okay, because hot fluid, the one which is cooled here is the hot fluid, okay, don't confuse, it is TH0, so 48.94 degrees Celsius. The effectiveness expression considering the heat gained by the cold fluid is given by epsilon is equal to Cc into Tc0 minus Tci divided by C minimum into Thi minus Tci. So upon substitution, all the values, effectiveness value we have calculated 0.646. Here Cc value is 1162.77 into Tc0 minus 10 divided by 232.64 into 120 minus 10. So upon calculation, the exit temperature of the cold fluid here, don't confuse, cold fluid is the hot fluid exit temperature. Cold fluid is one which is taken away the heat. So Tc0 equal to 24.22 degrees Celsius. So this completes the heat exchangers chapter. Before starting this heat transfer with phase change, if anybody having any doubts, any clarifications, in the beginning slide, okay, first slide, my email ID and my contact numbers are given. If anybody want to clarify the doubts, you may call to my numbers, or you may better call instead of mailing to the mail. So you cannot mail sometimes. We may not see for a whole day, but if you call, your doubts can be cleared away. And even if you can send queries to my mail ID also. Now, let me start with another chapter. The one more chapter in this fifth module is the heat transfer with phase change. Heat transfer with phase change. Here, this phase change you have studied in your first year elements of mechanical engineering, formation of steam. In that, what you did is, you have taken ice at 0 degree Celsius and you have started supplying heat. So it is first ice to liquid, then liquid to vapor. So the phase change occurs. Then question arises, why to learn this topic? Why it is kept for mechanical engineers? Because mechanical engineers are the main designers of all turbines and heat engines. The steam turbine, okay, steam turbine is a device which is used to develop, generate work, or develop the electrical energy, or we can say it is that steam turbine will convert one form of energy available to steam into a mechanical energy. That mechanical energy, or the shaft which is connected to the alternator or the generator, it will generate electricity. Hence, understanding of this heat transfer with phase change is important for the mechanical engineers. Okay, and this heat transfer with the phase change is a convection process, and it is of great importance those involving with boiling and condensation. Okay, if you take an example of steam thermal power stations, steam thermal power stations, it may be a coal-fired or a nuclear power station. There we, in coal-fired power station, water is boiled in the boiler and it is converted into a steam, and this steam is used to run the steam turbine. And after performing the work, the steam which is coming out of the turbine exhaust, it is cooled in a condenser. This condenser is nothing but a heat exchanger. This you have studied in the previous class. Boiler is nothing but a condenser. You know, the temperature distribution, what about the temperature distribution when there is a boiling of a fluid or when there is a condensation of the fluid, you come across. The boiling fluid temperature remains constant. You have come across this temperature distribution, and condensation fluid always remains constant. Okay, so hence these two, boiling as well as condensation, are very, very, very important for the mechanical engineers. And if you know the fundamentals of these boiling and condensation, already you have studied the surface knowledge, but these boiling and condensation are the heat transfer with phase change processes. And again, what you did in the convection chapter, here also you are evaluating the convection heat transfer coefficient, because heat transfer, the fluid is there. Whenever you come across the heat transfer from fluid to the surface or surface to the fluid, you call it as a convection heat transfer. For that you require the value of convective heat transfer coefficient, but these convective heat transfer coefficient in boiling and condensation, they are, compared to the convection chapters what you have learned, free convection as well as forced convection, the force convection value, you know, you have, if you refer to any heat transfer textbook, the value of convective heat transfer coefficient lies between around 10 to 100 watt per meter square degree Celsius. Whereas for boiling and condensation, the convective heat transfer coefficient value is of the order of thousands together, lakhs together. If in actual thermal power stations, if you go, it is of the order of 1,17,000. Up to that you will get, depending upon the your capacity of the plant, how it is designed. So the examples for boiling and condensation, you know, steam thermal power station. Next is the refrigeration cycles. Refrigeration cycle, you know, refrigeration, what happens? Low boiling liquid is used. Okay, refrigeration, we have studied in our first year elements of mechanical engineering, and those who have studied this refrigeration and air conditioning as a one either core subject or elective subject, you are aware of these refrigeration cycles. Here what happens, low boiling liquid is passed through the compartment where we will keep the food items. If you take an example of a house refrigerator, it is converted into vapor by absorbing the heat from the compartment, then it is condensed in the condenser. Okay, so by condenser is a cross flow heat exchanger in with respect to refrigeration cycle. Condenser, which is used, is a cross flow heat exchanger. The refrigerant flows from top to bottom, and back side of the condenser the air is blown over the surface of the tube, so the cooling of the refrigerant will take place. And chemical engineering plants like your MRPL, Mangalore Refineries and Petrochemical Limited, the MCF Mangalore Chemicals and Fertilizers, many chemical engineering plants are pharmaceutical drugs factories. Wherever you come across, even your sugar industries, if you take, their steam generation will come into picture. Wherever you go, so boiling and condensation, these are the universal phenomena you come across. So hence, the engineer must understand the processes involved in order to design the appropriate heat transfer device. So if you have the knowledge of the boiling process as well as the condensation process, we can better design a heat transfer device. Remember, not only it is heat transfer design, material selection comes into picture. Your material science is also one of the beautiful subject. So finally, depending upon your requirement, you choose the material. But our students, the material science, they will learn it as a just theory subject, but it is one of the beautiful subject. Don't take it lightly. It is one of the important subject. Here, if at all you have to design a better heat transfer device, you have to choose the materials depending upon your the requirement. And it makes you very easy if you know the material properties very easily. Okay, that's why the engineer must understand all the subjects, study all the subjects carefully. And you know, high heat transfer rates, as I already mentioned, we come across the high convective heat transfer coefficient values. Obviously, the heat transfer rates involved in boiling and condensation are very high. Okay, and you are aware about this, the boiling process. Okay, right from your first semester, you are aware when the boiling occurs. Okay. You know, when the temperature of a liquid at a specified pressure, okay, you have learned in your elements of mechanical engineering, formation of steam at constant pressure. And this liquid state, the temperature of a liquid at a specified pressure is raised to the saturation temperature. At that pressure, boiling occurs. You may keep the pressure constant or you may keep on changes. And you might have studied about the triple point of water in your thermodynamics. Okay, that knowledge so is also helpful. To understand this, okay, at the same pressure it exists in all the three, solid, liquid and vapor. Okay, so that means just upon changing the pressure, okay, at that pressure, when it is, the liquid is raised to the saturation temperature. Saturation temperature is one at which the boiling occurs. Similarly, with respect to boiling, it is saturation temperature at which the boiling occurs. And with respect to condensation, saturation temperature is the temperature at which the condensation occurs. Okay. Depending upon the requirement, you have to denote these two saturation temperature. Whether we are dealing with the boiling heat transfer process or the condensation heat transfer process, accordingly, we can use this. Similarly, when the just now I told, when the temperature of a vapor is lower to saturation temperature, condensation occurs. Okay. Both these processes, boiling and condensation, are considered to be forms of convection heat transfer since they involve fluid motion. At the same time, boiling and condensation processes depend on the latent heat of vaporization, HFG. If you have studied about this and you, in your thermodynamics as well as elements of mechanical engineering, both the processes, condensation and boiling processes, depend on the latent heat of vaporization of the liquid and the surface tension. This you have studied in your fluid mechanics at the liquid vapor interface. So to understand the boiling and condensation processes, we must know the have the knowledge of latent heat of vaporization of the liquid, surface tension at the liquid vapor interface, in addition to the properties of the fluid in each phase. It may be a boiling process or it may be a condensation process. Steam properties, as you have studied, if the boiling process, suppose if you generating steam using water, we know the water properties. So that means, along with the properties of the fluids in either phase, it may be a boiling or condensation, we should have the knowledge of latent heat of vaporization as well as the surface tension at the liquid vapor interface. Under equilibrium conditions, okay, the temperature remains constant during a phase change process at a fixed process. Suppose if the it is an equilibrium process. Equilibrium, you can understand the heat transfer, whatever the heat, for example, the condensation, whatever the heat given by the steam, it is carried away by the cooling water. That you call it as a no loss conditions. Under equilibrium conditions, the temperature remains constant during a phase change process at a fixed pressure. But it is necessary to maintain some difference between the surface temperature and saturation temperature for effective heat transfer. For example, if it is a condensation process, okay, saturation temperature is the temperature at which condensation occurs, and it is the surface temperature is the surface temperature of the tube through which cold water is flowing. So we need to keep some temperature difference, because if TS and T saturation they are same, then condensation will not occur. We need to keep certain temperature difference so that the effective heat transfer will occur. And if that means, for example, if the water which is flowing through a condenser tubes, there is a large difference if the cold water is used, for example, tap water 30 degrees Celsius and sending 80 degrees Celsius or 100 degrees Celsius, they have a different heat transfer rates. So that means, so for effective heat transfer, whenever the condensation or the boiling occurs, we need to keep the temperature difference between this surface temperature as well as the saturation temperatures. As I have already mentioned, you have learned in convection chapters, the convection chapter purpose is to find determine the values of the convective heat transfer coefficients. But heat transfer coefficients associated with boiling and condensations are typically much higher than those associated with the convection processes. I have given, you take an example of a natural convection, it lies between just around 5 to 25 or 30 watt per meter square degree Celsius. For convection, it may be between around 10 to 100 watt per meter square, but for boiling and condensation, they are of the order of thousands. Okay, say up till 1 lakh or 1,17,000, 25,000. So you come across such higher values. So that means it poses a problem in design of a either boiler or a condenser. So for that reason, we must understand the concepts very clearly. Now let us, with this brief background on the heat transfer with phase change, first let me start with the boiling heat transfer. After completion of this boiling heat transfer process, we start with the condensation process. Okay. Boiling and condensation, these are the boiling is a reverse process of condensation, or condensation is the reverse process of boiling. You can state in either way. Okay. Now let us start with the boiling heat transfer. Boiling is a convection process. You know what happens boiling. You have studied about the boilers. Okay. Those who have studied energy conversion engineering that is power plant engineering, you come across various types of forced circulation boilers. Nowadays we are using forced circulation boilers in thermal power stations. In forced circulation boilers, what happens? Water is allowed to flow through the tube. Water tube boilers and fire tube boilers, you come across water is allowed to flow through the tubes, and the hot gases released due to the combustion of the fuel. Suppose if it is a coal-fired thermal power station, heat released because of the combustion of the fuel, they are carried with the products of combustion, and they are allowed to flow over the surface of the boiler tubes. Okay, the heat of the hot flue gases is given to the water, and it is converted into a steam. So hence this boiling occurs when liquid is in contact with a surface maintained at a temperature higher than the saturation temperature of the liquid. So for boiling to occur, the temperature of the liquid is in contact with the surface maintained at a temperature higher than the saturation temperature of the liquid. For example, you see the boiling at atmospheric pressure, say water boiling occurs at 100 degrees Celsius atmospheric pressure. So this is the 100 degrees Celsius is the saturation temperature at which the boiling occurs. But you have already learned from your steam tables, depending upon the pressure, the temperature will keeps on change, saturation temperature. So depend, that is also possible that we can generate steam with the varying pressures. Okay. So that means the boiling occurs when a liquid is in contact with a surface maintained at a temperature higher than the saturation temperature of the liquid. That means if at all the boiling has to occur, the surface temperature has to be higher than that of the saturation temperature of the liquid. That you have to keep it in your mind. The boiling heat flux from a solid surface to the liquid, because you know just now I have given as the example of a boilers, heat is transferred from a tube surface to the liquid which is flowing inside, that is the water. So obviously it is a convection process. Boiling is a convection process, and we can calculate the boiling heat flux using Newton's law of cooling. The boiling heat flux from a solid surface to the liquid is given by Newton's law of cooling, that you are aware of this Newton's law of either cooling or a heating. It may be a cooling, not necessarily cooling, or it may be a heating. Either way, it is possible. Q boiling, that is the boiling heat flux, is equal to H into TS minus T saturation. That is equal to H into delta T excess. This difference of these two temperatures, saturation surface temperature minus saturation temperature, is called the excess temperature. Excess temperature, delta T excess, is equal to TS minus T saturation. TS minus T saturation. We can classify boiling heat transfer into two types of full boiling, or another one is flow boiling or forced convection boiling. Full boiling is one in which the heat is added to the liquid from a submerged solid surface. So one simple example I can give is your electrical geyser or immersion heater coil. Okay, normally students are in your hostels or in your PG paying guest rooms. Okay, what you will do is during the winter season, you will take an electrical heater and it will submerge it into a pot which is filled with water, and you heated water you will use it for the bathing purpose. That is a pool boiling. Here heat is added to the liquid from a submerged solid surface. Here heater coil is submerged in the liquid, and once you switch on the button, electrical energy flows through the coil. Due to the flow of electric current, you know, heat is being generated. This heat is transferred to the surrounding fluid. So it is a submerged, it is such type of boiling, whatever it may be. You are not boiling water there, but you are heating. Sometimes if you heat it for a longer period, definitely you will see the boiling also there, and you see some vapor coming out of your pot. Whereas flow boiling occurs in a flowing stream, in thermal power stations, water tube boilers. The fluid water is flowing continuously through the boiler tubes, and the hot gases are flowing around the surface of the tube, so the heat transfer takes place during the flow. This flow boiling occurs in a flowing stream, and the boiling surface may itself be a portion of the flow flow passage. The boiling surface, that is the water tube boiler, is a surface, may itself be a portion of the flow passage. Full and flow boiling are further classified. We can classify them as subcooled or local boiling, as well as saturated or bulk boiling. Okay, and we can call the boiling as a subcooled or local boiling. Boiling is said to be subcooled or local boiling when the temperature of the main body of the liquid is below the saturation temperature. If the main body of the liquid, suppose if it is below the saturation temperature, it is called the subcooled or the local. Just now I have given an example of heating up a water in a pot which is filled with the water, but with the help of a immersion, it is a subcooled boiling. You can say the main body of the liquid is below the saturation temperature. Okay, suppose if the saturation temperature is equal to or higher than that of the saturation temperature, the boiling is said to be saturated or bulk boiling. Boiling is said to be saturated or bulk when the temperature of the liquid is equal to or higher than that of the saturation temperature. Full and flow boiling, we can classify them as subcooled or local boiling or saturated boiling. Boiling is said to be subcooled if the temperature of the main body of the liquid is below the saturation temperature, the saturation temperature at which boiling occurs. Suppose if it is above the saturation temperature, then the liquid temperature, then it is called the saturated or the bulk boiling. Now, let us start with the boiling regimes and boiling curve. Let me start with the boiling regimes and boiling curve. The different regimes of the full boiling done by S. Nukiyama in 1934. Nukiyama has used electrically heated nichrome and platinum wires immersed in liquids in his experiments. Depending upon the excess temperature, boiling takes different forms, and they are natural convection boiling, nucleate boiling, transition boiling, and film boiling. So Nukiyama has used electrically heated nichrome and platinum wires immersed in liquid to plot the boiling regimes and to draw the boiling curve in 1934, and depending upon the excess temperature, boiling takes different forms, and they are natural convection boiling, nucleate boiling, transition boiling, and film boiling. Now, these are the boiling curve for water at 1 atmospheric pressure given by Nukiyama. Okay, now you can see there are different regimes. It is denoted by this colored one. You can see this variation of the boiling heat flux, and x-axis is excess temperature. It gives excess temperature, which is the difference of saturation temperature, surface temperature minus saturation temperature. Okay, first one is the natural convection. Up to point A, natural convection boiling occurs. In between A to C, it is a nucleate boiling. Further, this A to C is divided into two regimes. In this, A to B, bubbles collapse in the liquid. B to C, bubbles raise to the free surface. And once point C, it is the maximum or the critical, that when the excess delta T is around 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, nucleate boiling ends. You can see from the graph, when delta T excess ends, nucleate, and thereafter it is called the transition boiling. Between C and D, it is the transition boiling, and thereafter between point D and E, it is called the leaden frost point. This is a Q minimum here, this is the Q maximum here. C is the Q max point, D is the Q minimum, leaden frost point, that is the Q minimum point, and in this region film boiling occurs. Now let us discuss each boiling regimes. First one is natural convection boiling. And it is a known fact that from the thermodynamics, when a pure substance starts boiling, when it reaches the saturation temperature, where I all know, in this regime, the energy transfer from the heated surface to the saturated liquid takes place by natural or free convection. This you have studied, natural or free convection, the movement of the fluid particles as a result of the density difference caused by the buoyancy effects. Okay. Now here in this region, the surface is only around few degrees. For water, it is 2 to 6 degrees above the saturation temperature of the liquid. Okay, just for example, at 1 atmospheric pressure, if water boils at 100 degree, so this, in this new natural convection boiling, it is 1 or 2 degrees Celsius. This I think you might have experienced this boiling up for heating of water in a kettle or a container on a LPG stove. If you start heating, initially you see the formation of the bubble at the bottom of the container, and thereafter they will try to leave the surface. They will disappear. This is the natural convection boiling. Today, if you have not conducted that heating of a water, today go and heat the water, glass of water in a kettle or a container. You can see, just look carefully, you will see the bubbles at the bottom of the container, then they will disappear. And finally, upon a further addition of the heat, if you keep on adding the heat, you will see the bubbles coming out of the surface and they will fall down, because they will transfer that heat to the surrounding air, and latent heat of vaporization is reduced and fall back to the surface. And further addition heat, they will come, you will see the vapor movement in the container. This experiment, simple experiment, you can today go and conduct, and you can see that. Here, free convection currents are sufficient to remove the heat from the surface. The free convections are sufficient to remove the heat from the... In this case, liquid is slightly heated in this case, and the evaporates when rises to the surface. That is called the metastable condition. Now, let us discuss about the nucleate boiling. Bubbles which are formed on the surface of the heater can be separated into two regions. Okay, now I was told you about the formation of the bubbles which are formed on the surface of the heater can be separated into two regions. It is nucleate boiling. First one is nucleate boiling. In the region A to B, just now I have given the example of the heating up a water in a container. Today, if not done, go and do this. You will understand this nucleate boiling very clearly. Bubbles start to form on the heater surface. You can see heater surface. Here, heater surface is the, in the example what I have given is the bottom surface of the container. There is the wires that Nukeyama what he has conducted is the platinum or the platinum wires what he has used. Heater surface and dissipate into the liquid as soon as the bubbles are detached from the surface. Just now I have shown further addition of heat. They will detach from the surface and they will disintegrate into the surrounding fluid. Continuous column of vapor has been observed in the region B to C due to the numerous nucleation sites and increased bubble generation rate. So further addition of heat, if you keep on increase the excess temperature, the continuous column of vapor that is observed. So the no bubbles, the continuous column of vapor you will observe between the region B and C. And it is possible to have higher heat flux rates obtainable in this region. Nucleate boiling. Nucleate boiling is the most desirable in practical applications due to large heat flux rate with small temperature difference. Okay, nucleate boiling is the most desirable boiling region in practical applications. Increase in the excess temperature increases the heat flux rapidly until peak heat flux is reached. This particular stage is known as the critical heat flux. Excess temperature above this point may result in the burnout or melting of the heating element. If you go with a nichrome or a platinum heating element, so above this point, once the critical point is reached, vapor formation occurs. You know, vapor is a very bad conductor of heat. It will not allow the heat to flow very easily. This you might have experienced in your house. Whenever a few drops of fall on a heated surface in your kitchen, heated metallic surface which is used for either baking a roti or chapati, so just pour one or two to three drops of water on that heated metal surface, immediately you will observe the churr sound with water droplets dancing for a few seconds. Okay. This is why, because the water molecule which is in contact with the heated surface initially converted into a vapor, and it will not allow the vapor heat to pass through it. Hence, they will dance for a few seconds and later it will be evaporated. So this also you can experience at your house in the kitchen. It is possible. So next is the film boiling. Film boiling. Increase in the excess temperature results in the reduction of heat flux due to the blanketing of the heater surface with the vapor film. Just as I have shown, vapor is a very bad conductor of heat. It will not allow the, so the, it will reduce the, that's why you have seen the degrees, that heat flux started decreasing in the graph. You can just go through that graph. So it is decreasing. In this regime, heat flux dropped to a minimum. That is the Leyden's fourth point. That is point D that I have shown in the beginning of this while showing the graph, that is the pool boiling curve, because a continuous vapor film covers the heater surface. This is known as the stable film boiling. Okay, between point C and D, it is a stable film boiling. Okay, stable film formed, that is called the stable film boiling. Heat flux begins to increase. Suppose if you further increase in the heat flux, increasing the excess temperature due to sufficient higher temperature at the surface as a result of thermal radiation effects. Film boiling occurs. Why it occurs? Due to thermal radiation effects. Film boiling occurs in the due to the increase in the heat flux due to excess temperature increase, that is as a result of the sufficient higher temperature at the heater surface as a result of thermal radiation effects. The film boiling, once the vapor film is formed, that the reason after D, A, B, C, D, D, then E, between that reason is called the film boiling reason. It is that thermal radiation effects also comes into picture, there further increase in the excess temperature. Most of the boiling heat transfer equipments in practice operate slightly below the critical heat flux to avoid the any disastrous burnout. So almost all the boiling equipments which you come across nowadays, it may be a industries, thermal power stations, any chemical industries, they operate below this critical heat flux to avoid burnout. Once you heat the equipments above this critical heat flux, what happens? Film boiling comes into picture. The vapor which is formed is a bad conductor of heat, that will result in the, due to the improper transfer of heat, overheating takes place, so that may result in the burnout of the surface. However, it is not true with the cryogenic applications involving fluids with very low boiling points such as oxygen and nitrogen. Stable film boil point usually falls below the melting point of the heater materials. The same may not true with the cryogenic applications. So we can go up to, because the it involves, in cryogenic applications, it involves fluids with very low boiling points. It may be a cryogenic fluids, it may be oxygen or nitrogen. Stable film boiling point usually falls below the melting point of the heater materials. So there is no problem in, you can go up to that even film boiling with respect to cryogenic applications. Hence, steady film boiling can be used in these cases without any danger of burnout. Okay. Suppose if you take an example of the boiling of a water, then we need to operate the equipment below the critical heat flux, because vapor formed as a result of the heating of water is a bad conductor of heat. The same is not true with the cryogenic applications. Without any danger, we can use film boiling. We can operate the cryogenic equipments in film boiling region without any danger of burnout. So you can see this, the boiling regimes progress for the copper rod immersed in the isopropanol. So you can see this. Now you can see the bubble formation here, the nucleate. Then this is the stable film boiling, you can say. So you can see bubbles are vanished here, but still you can see the vapor film here. But this is the film boiling here, film boiling, you can see this region. What I am, cursor is moving, the nucleate boiling, okay. It is a some stable boiling here. Next, this is a film boiling, this region. It is a heated copper rod immersed in isopropanol. You can see the bubble formation, nucleate boiling. After nucleate, bubbles raise to the surface. The column of paper you can see here, column of paper. Then this is the vapor which is formed. You can see the vapor has blanketing the copper rod, you can see. So it will not allow the copper rod is blanketed by the vapor, you can see this region. Okay, left, right side part. Left side, okay. Heated rod is immersed in the isopropanol liquid. So other end heat is very less. This is the heater end, heating end. So here heat flux is very less. So bubbles you can see. Here it is less air compared to this region. So vapor film. Here it is very high. So you can see the vapor that has blanketed the copper rod. Oh, let me stop. We will continue in the next class.